Welcome to the Deep Dive. Today, we're really zeroing in on a brand new processor, the AMD Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395. What makes this chip special?
Yeah, our goal here is to, you know, cut through some of the tech speak and figure out what advantages this processor really brings, not just compared to other AMD chips, but against some pretty serious competition too.
Exactly. We've been digging through quite a few in-depth analyses, mostly from YouTube, sources that really put the Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395 through its paces. We're looking at how it stacks up against, say, the Ryzen AI 9HX 370, also the much talked about Apple M4 Pro,
right?
And even, get this, a dedicated NVIDIA RTX 4060 graphics card in a laptop.
That's the big question, isn't it? The integrated graphics potential.
It really is. Yeah. So we're planning to unpack everything. The raw CPU, power cores, clocks, cache, its integrated graphics capabilities, power use, and crucially, how all that translates into what you can actually do with it. You know, gaming, work, everyday stuff.
Okay. Sounds like a plan. Where should we start?
Okay, let's unpack this. First up, let's pit the Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395 against another important AMD chip, the Ryzen AI 9HX 370.
Okay, it's useful to remember these didn't launch together. The 395, it came out about 6 months after the 370.
Yeah, right, good context.
And right off the bat, one of the biggest differences you'll spot is the core count. The 395 has a pretty beefy 16 cores and 32 threads.
Wow, okay.
Whereas the 370 has 12 cores and 24 threads. Now, what's the real benefit of more cores and threads? Well, think of it like having more workers on a project. You could just tackle more tasks at once and handle those really demanding, multifaceted workloads much more efficiently.
That makes total sense. And looking at clock speeds, the 395 starts higher, right? A 3.0 gigahertz base clock.
Yep, compared to the 370's 2.0 gigahertz base. But interestingly, they both share that same top boost speed, 5.1 gigahertz.
So same potential peak burst, but the 395 has a higher starting point. Now, what about cache, that close in memory?
They both have the same L1 and L2 cache per core, which is that super fast memory right next to the processing units.
Okay.
But the L3 cache, that's where the 395 really pulls ahead. It's got a significantly larger L3 cache. We're talking 64 megabytes more.
64 megs? That's quite a jump. What does that do in practice?
Well, that extra L3 cache acts like a bigger, faster short-term memory for the processor. It holds more frequently used data, so the chip doesn't have to fetch it from the main system RAM as often.
Which takes longer, right?
Exactly. So you get to quicker data access, a more responsive system overall. It really helps when you're dealing with large files or complex apps.
Gotcha. And speaking of main system memory, RAM, the 395, supports up to 128 GB.
It does. While the 370, interestingly, actually goes higher, up to 256 GB.
Oh, okay. That's unexpected.
It is a bit, yeah.
Yeah.
But both support the same type of fast RAM that LPDDR5X and at the same speeds.
And one thing for the pros, the 395 supports ECC memory, error correcting code.
That's right. Which is crucial for systems where data integrity is absolutely non-negotiable, like servers or high-end workstations. The 370 doesn't have that feature.
Okay. And connections, like for graphics cards, storage, PCIe.
Both are on PCIe 4.0, and both offer 16 lanes.
Yeah.
So pretty standard high-speed connectivity there.
Now, power draw, TDP. The 395 runs a bit hotter, or potentially hotter, 45 to 55 watts.
Yeah, that's its range, compared to the 370's wider 15 to 54 watt range.
Mm.
And that TDP range gives us clues about the performance versus power balance.
How so?
Well, the 395's higher minimum TDP allows it to draw more power consistently. That lets those extra cores and higher base clocks really perform.
Makes sense. More power in, more performance out.
But the trade-off is potentially more heat and maybe shorter battery life in a laptop compared to the 370. The 370 offers more flexibility there, maybe better for laptops, where you really need that battery to last.
So different targets, essentially. Hmm. Which brings us to benchmarks. How do they actually stack up in tests?
Exactly. The sources we looked at consistently show the Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395 scoring higher in things like Cinebench R23 and Geekbench 6.
Which lines up perfectly with the specs we just discussed.
It does. So if you're choosing between them, the 395 looks like the clear choice for anyone needing absolute maximum performance. Think demanding professional work, desktops, workstations.
And the 370.
That seems like a really strong option for high performance laptops where you still want a decent balance between that power and battery life.
Okay, that's a really clear distinction. Now, let's pivot. There's been a lot of talk about AMD having its Apple Silicon moment. How does this 395 compare to Apple's M4 Pro?
Yes. That comparison is generating a lot of buzz. You could feel the excitement around the 395's announcement at CES 2025. People were definitely seeing it as AMD finally stepping up to challenge Apple Silicon head-on.
And some of those leaked benchmarks looked pretty impressive, right? Geekbench multi-core scores. What was it, around 21,000?
Yeah, around that mark.
Okay.
Which puts it squarely in the same league as the M4 Pro. And some sources even suggested its Cinebench multi-core score might edge out the 12-core M4 Pro.
Though maybe not the higher core count M4 Pros.
Potentially, yeah. It might still trail the absolute top-end M4 Pro variants, but just being in that conversation is huge for AMD.
Absolutely. It addresses that long-running narrative, you know, AMD trying to catch up to Apple's efficiency and performance lead. These results suggest they've made some serious strides.
And it's not just the CPU. The integrated graphics are looking really promising, too. OpenCL scores around 100,000. That's competitive with the M4 Pro's graphics.
Maybe even the 16-core M4 Pro GPU?
Possibly rivaling it, yeah. The very top-end 20-core M4 Pro might still be ahead. But for integrated graphics from AMD, this is a remarkable step up.
It really feels like a potential shift. Now, quick clarification, one source mentioned the Asus ROG Zephyrus G16 laptop using the 395.
Oh yeah, I saw that too.
But another source corrected that the G16 actually has a dedicated NVIDIA RTX 90 series GPU. The actual device used for the head-to-head tests against the M4 Pro was the Asus ROG Flow Z13.
Right, the tablet form factor, that's a crucial detail. So the ROG Flow Z13, this 13-inch tablet, is packing the 395 and was the platform for those Apple comparisons. Important context as we move forward.
Definitely. So let's stick with that Z13 and tackle another fascinating comparison. Those integrated graphics, the Radeon 8060S versus a dedicated NVIDIA RTX 4060 laptop GPU, can integrated really compete?
This is where things get really interesting, showing just how far integrated solutions have come. So the test setup was that Asus ROG Flow Z13 with the 395.
To the tablet.
Against the Lenovo Legion Slim 5. That's a proper 15-inch gaming laptop with the RTX 4060 running at its full 100-watt power limit.
Very different machines. Size, cooling, price. The Z13 is pricier, right?
Significantly, yeah.
Yeah.
And we need to keep those differences in mind. Also, the CPU advantage in the Z13, that newer Zen 5 architecture in the 395, is considerably faster than the older Zen 4 in the chip paired with the 4060 in the Lenovo.
Like 60% faster multi-core and Geekbench, something like that.
Around that, yeah, and about 10% faster single core. So the CPU isn't an equal comparison here. The Z13 has the edge.
Okay, and graphics memory. The Z13 lets you allocate system RAM to the GPU.
It does. Most tests set it to 8GB to match the 8GB of dedicated VRAM on the RTX 4060. And interestingly, initial tests didn't show a massive jump going from 8GB to 16GB allocated RAM for the 8GPU.
Suggesting 8GB was enough for those specific tests, maybe?
Seems likely for the games and settings they used.
Ah.
Okay, let's dive into some game benchmarks. Alan Wake 2.
Yeah.
AMD's integrated graphics actually showed a slight lead in average FPS at both 1080p and 1440p.
Really? Against a 4060?
Yep. But turn on ray tracing. NVIDIA pulls ahead at 1080p. Though surprisingly, AMD just about kept its nose in front at 1440p ray tracing.
Huh. Though they noted visual differences, right? FSR versus DLSS upscaling.
Exactly. DLSS is often seen as giving a sharper image. So performance isn't the whole story there.
Okay, what about Cyberpunk 2077? Always a tough one.
Very close to 1080p. AMD actually had better 1% lows at 1440p, which can mean smoother gameplay, fewer stutters.
But ray tracing.
Big win for the RTX 4060 there, no surprise, really. Then you have games like Marvel Rivals and Space Marine 2, where the 4060 generally led an average FPS, and there was some stuttering noted on the AMD side in Space Marine 2.
But then Spider-Man 2 was a win for AMD.
An average FPS, yes. A notable win, actually. Though again, the testers felt the NVIDIA experience might have looked better or felt smoother due to DLSS.
Yeah, swings and roundabouts.
Definitely. Then Black Myth. Wukong and Stalker 2 were pretty clear wins for the RTX 4060, especially with ray tracing enabled. The AMD graphics really struggled there.
Borderlands 3.
AMD slightly ahead. Which kind of lines up with AMD's own comparisons against lower power RTX 4070s sometimes.
Okay. And Red Dead 2.
That was an unexpected, significant win for NVIDIA.
Interesting. So what's the overall picture across, say, non-ray traced games?
Looking across 24 games without ray tracing, the RTX 4060 and the bigger laptop was on average about 13% faster at 1080p and 8% faster at 1440p.
So the 4060 is still faster overall, but not by a massive margin in many cases.
Pretty much. AMD led in a few titles, but often by smaller amounts. What's really impressive, though, is that the Radeon 8060S integrated graphics got close to averaging 60 FPS at 1440p high settings across that range of games.
That is impressive for integrated.
It really is. Now, factor in ray tracing, and NVIDIA generally takes the crown, though AMD had surprising moments in Spider-Man 2 and Alan Wake 2 at 1440p.
So the takeaway?
The RTX 4060 and a larger, better cooled, probably cheaper laptop is generally the better bet for pure gaming performance. But the Ryzen Max Plus 395's integrated graphics are incredibly capable for what they are, offering a new level of performance for thin and light or tablet gaming. Price is a big factor too.
Definitely. Okay, let's shift focus again. Real world productivity, that direct comparison. The Ryzen AI Max Plus 395 and the ROG Flow Z13 tablet versus the Apple M4 Pro and a MacBook Pro. How do they handle actual work?
Right, this gets down to everyday use and creative tasks. So the ROG Flow Z13, we know it's that 13-inch tablet, detachable keyboard, kickstand.
Nice screen too, right? 2.5K, 180 hertz.
Yep, great display. Up to 128 GB RAM, integrated graphics only. Good build, decent ports for a tablet.
Okay. And the M4 Pro MacBook Pro. Benchmark basics first. Geekbench CPU.
M4 Pro has a clear single-core advantage, about 26% faster. Not surprising given Apple's focus there.
But multi-core.
Much closer. Only about an 11% difference favoring the M4 Pro. And remember, the M4 Pro is on that newer 3-nanometer process versus 4-nanometer for the Ryzen. That efficiency difference can play a role.
Good point. And battery performance. Did the Z13 throttle much off power?
There was a noticeable drop in multi-core performance on battery, yeah. Likely due to power limits in that thin tablet form factor.
So the chip might do even better in a full laptop chassis?
It suggests that yes, more potential headroom with better cooling and power. Now, Geekbench compute graphics power.
M4 Pro still ahead.
Slightly. About 19% faster in OpenCL.
But then in a gaming benchmark, 3DMark Steel Nomad Lite.
The Z13's Ryzen graphics actually beat the M4 Pro, over 27% higher FPS.
Wow, shows the game compatibility difference on by 8.1, maybe?
Absolutely. Apple's getting better, but by 86 still has the edge for broad game support. Now, sustained load Cinebench stress test.
How did they hold up?
The Z13 sustained clocks were lower than the M4 Pro's, despite the Ryzen having a higher peak boost. But get this, the Z13 ran cooler and quieter.
Even though the M4 Pro hit higher peak temps.
Exactly. And here's the kicker. In the standard Cinebench multi-core run, the Z13 actually beat the M4 Pro's score.
Whoa. Okay, that's a big result. Demonstrates serious multi-core muscle.
It really does. But then you look at everyday web tasks, like the Speedometer 3.0 benchmark.
Single core heavy.
Yep, and the M4 Pro was significantly faster there. Makes sense.
Creative apps, Figma for web design.
Both handle complex files really well. Zooming, loading very smooth,
yeah.
And exporting 12 high-res layers. Surprisingly, almost identical times.
Okay, neck and neck there. What about something heavier, like Blender rendering?
This was really eye-opening. The Z13's integrated graphics using AMD's HIP tech,
yeah,
and Blender's experimental ray tracing,
yeah,
managed to get very close to the M4 Pro's render times, which is impressive considering Blender on Mac is usually very well optimized for Apple Silicon.
And they tried giving the Z13's graphics more RAM, like 16 GB instead of 8 GB.
They did. Didn't make much difference for that specific Blender test,
yeah,
but it shows the flexibility you have being able to adjust that allocation.
Okay, one more demanding test. Lightroom Classic. Exporting 500 raw images, that hits everything, right? CPU, GPU, memory.
Oh yeah, it's a heavy one.
Yeah.
Initially, the Mac was faster out of the gate.
But
the Z13 caught up and finished just a tiny bit behind. But here's what's really interesting. They re-ran the test after allocating more RAM to the CPU on the Z13. Performance jumped significantly. It actually surpassed the unbinned M4 Pro in that Lightroom export.
Seriously? Just by changing RAM allocation?
Yep. It highlights how differently they use resources too. The Mac leaned heavily on its GPU for Lightroom, while the Z13 seemed to be more CPU bound until they gave the CPU more memory headroom.
Fascinating. So the overall impression from these real-world tests?
The Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395 in that Z13 delivers genuinely impressive productivity performance. It often punched above its weight, especially for integrated graphics, and really competed closely with the M4 Pro in many tough tasks. That RAM flexibility is a real ace up its sleeve in certain workflows.
Okay, great context. Now, just to round out the AMD picture, let's briefly touch on a comparison with a lower tier AMD chip, the Ryzen AI 7350. This came from a Vietnamese source.
That's right. It helps position the 395 within AMD's own lineup. And the difference is pretty stark.
CPU-wise.
The 395 has double the cores and threads, higher clocks, much bigger L3 cache. The result, about 15% better single-core in Cinebench R23, but almost double the multi-core score compared to the 7350.
Huge gap in multi-core and graphics.
Even bigger gap. The Radeon 860S and the 395 is just in a different league compared to the Radeon 860M and the 7350. We're talking like 40 compute units versus 8. Way more rendering power.
But the 7350 sips power, right? Lower TDP.
Much lower. Typically around 28 watts compared to the 45-55 watts base for the 395, which can boost way higher.
So again, different targets. 395 for peak performance, 7350 for efficiency and battery life in more mainstream laptops.
Exactly. The source had a useful table comparing specs, side-by-side architecture, cores, clocks, cache, GPU details, benchmarks, TDP, RAM support.
And it just reinforces the 395's dominance.
Completely. More cores, higher speeds, much stronger iGPU. The 7350 is positioned as, you know, good for general tasks, better battery, more cost-effective. Still decent, but not in the same performance tier.
What about the AI part, the MPU?
Both have similar MPU specs on paper XDNA 2, up to 50 TOPS.
Yeah.
But the 395's higher overall power budget probably lets it use that MPU potential more effectively in demanding AI tasks.
Memory support difference, too.
Yeah. The 395 gets quad-channel LPDDR5X with ECC support. The 7350 is dual-channel LPDDR5X or DDR5, no ECC.
And ranking-wise, where do they sit?
The 395 is seen as a top 10 laptop CPU right now. The 7350 is more like top 30, clearly highlights the performance difference.
So bottom line, 395 is the high-end choice, the powerhouse, especially for multi-core and graphics work. 7350 is the efficient mobile option.
Precisely. Help see just how capable that 395 really is within AMD's current stack. It's their clear flagship for demanding users.
All right, so as we start to wrap up this deep dive on the AMD Ryzen AI Max Plus Pro 395, wow. It's pretty clear this chip is a really significant step forward, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
Especially the integrated graphics.
Absolutely. It feels like more than just an incremental improvement. It's genuinely challenging dedicated mid-range GPUs and giving Apple Silicon a serious run for its money in several areas.
We saw that strong CPU performance, particularly multi-core, and those real-world productivity tests against the M4 Pro were, frankly, surprisingly competitive.
Yeah, and the flexibility of the architecture, being able to tweak memory allocation, that stood out as a real advantage in some cases.
For me, the aha moments were definitely seeing integrated graphics tray blows with an RTX 4060 in some games.
Right.
And seeing it perform so well against the M4 Pro and things like Blender and that boosted Lightroom test. Really impressive stuff.
And it definitely leaves us with some interesting questions moving forward. You know, how will this perform in different laptop designs with varying cooling?
Mm-hmm.
What happens when software gets more optimized for this specific chip? And of course, how will the next generation compare against whatever Intel and Apple bring out?
Oh, great points. And that brings us nicely to our final thought for you, the listener. As these integrated graphics keep getting better and better, really blurring the lines with dedicated GPUs, what does that mean for the future of laptops?
Yeah, how will manufacturers balance that raw power against efficiency and battery life? What will the trade-offs look like for different kinds of users down the road?
Definitely something to chew on. Thanks for taking this deep dive with us.
If you enjoy this video, please like, share, subscribe, and hit the bell to the latest update from my channel. Thank you for watching till the end, and see you in the next video.